Good morning and welcome to the 11th meeting of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2024. Our colleague Fergus Ewing will be joining us shortly. He's at our breakfast meeting in Parliament and will be coming along to proceedings as soon as that has concluded. Our first item this morning, agenda item one, is always the technical one, which is simply for colleagues to agree that we'll take agenda item four in private, which is where we consider the evidence that we have heard. Are we content? We are, and that brings us therefore to agenda item two, which is the consideration of continuing petitions. And the first of those is one we've spent a considerable amount of time discussing and taking evidence on, and it's petition number 1933, which is to allow the Ferneithy survivors to access Scotland's redress scheme, lodged by Iris Tinto on behalf of the Ferneithy survivors group. And again, I know some of the survivors who've been following the petition as it's made its way through the Scottish Parliament are with us this morning, and welcome to you. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to widen access to Scotland's redress scheme to allow Ferneithy survivors to seek redress. Now, we last considered this petition at our meeting on the 17th of April, when we agreed to write to the Law Society of Scotland, Thomson's solicitors, and at that point to the backbench MSP John Swinney. Members will recall that when we wrote to him in his backbench capacity, we were asking him to comment on submissions he'd made previously as Deputy First Minister, but of course he has now replied to our request in his capacity as First Minister, which is my way of saying it's not as candid as it might as otherwise have been in different circumstances. As well as the response from the First Minister, we've received responses from the organisations we wrote to, as well as from our petitioner. And all of those responses are set out in our papers for today, and members may wish to draw on the content of these submissions during today's meeting. And at that last consideration, we also agreed to invite Redress Scotland to give evidence, and I'm really pleased to welcome to this morning's meeting Joanna McCready, who's the Chief Executive of Redress Scotland, and Kirsty Darwin, who is the Chair of Redress Scotland. And I don't know whether our witnesses wish to say anything before we go into questions. Is there any prepared opening remarks, or are you happy just to feed in with the answers, with the comment, with questions, but whatever if suits you.
If I can just say a few or anything.
Yes, of course, that's
comments,
fine.
I
yes,
think
please
that
do.
Might be helpful.
Okay, Kirsty,
thank you. I'd really like to thank the committee for inviting us along today so that we can tell you a little bit more about the Redress Scotland scheme and let you understand better our position within that overall redress scheme. I'd like to start by mentioning the Ferneithy survivors and clearly stating that the abuse of children is abhorrent and wrong in all circumstances, and I recognise that a single incident abuse or abuse over a short period of time can have a lifelong impact. And I want that to be clearly noted. That is the position of Redress Scotland and it's the position of Joanna and I personally. I think it might be helpful to also say that as an organisation, we apply the legislation as it is legislation guidance in all of its forms in our panel decision making, and that those panels take great care in considering all of the information that is submitted to us, and that we would treat all survivors with compassion, dignity and respect, and consider each application on its facts as they stand. And I'm very happy to answer any further questions.
Thank you very much. And I mean, one of the reasons I think we thought it would be useful to have you along is because Redress Scotland's, it's two words that we've kept hearing throughout this whole process without really having any particular understanding of the organisation. And it's also, possibly unfairly to you, I felt at times been the case, well, that's nothing to do with us, that's Redress Scotland. And, you know, so we weren't at times clear where the authority actually lay, because at times it was being suggested you had no discretion to act, and at other times it's almost been suggested that you have all the discretion you care for to act. So might I just understand, in the first instance, what is your role and what is the Scottish Government's role? What is the distinction between the two, and where are the respective authorities in all of that, so that you now have a chance to make plain what your role and what the Scottish Government's role actually is?
Thank you. excuse me, I think that is helpful to outline. The redress scheme is complex in its setup, and that does mean that sometimes it's difficult to understand where the responsibilities individually lie. Obviously, the redress scheme was set up by Scottish ministers, and it was set up so that the redress division, which is within Scottish Government, receive applications from survivors. The caseworkers gather together the information to support the survivor, and when the survivor is content that that information has been gathered together, they then send that to Redress Scotland. Redress Scotland is independent of government. We sit separate from them, and we are constituted of independent panel members who are selected because of their skills and experience. They have backgrounds such as social work, law, clinical psychology, some former police officers, who are then able to make independent decisions on each application that we receive from a survivor. We do that absolutely with dignity, compassion and respect for the survivors, and we would consider each and every individual application very carefully at a panel hearing to make our decision. That decision is made on the basis of the Act, 21 Act, the regulations, which are particularly significant in the case of Fornethy survivors, and the statutory guidance, which was agreed by Parliament. We have to use that legislation, apply that legislation in our decision making. Within that decision making, there is some discretion, but it is limited in scope, and we're very happy to take you through that decision making process if that's helpful, so we can tell you when that discretion can be used. But we would consider eligibility first, which is outlined in the Act, and then eligibility, which there's statute on, which I say particularly is relevant because of the exclusion of those who've been within short-term care. And then we would apply guidance after that, and we would use that guidance to decide whether, for example, we could make a decision without supporting information. At that point, once we have made a decision, we would write a letter to the survivor allocating an award of redress, and we would then send that information back to the Scottish Government, who then would carry out that further piece of work to pay and to send information back out. But we are the middle bit of a larger, more complex process, and effectively are the decision makers. We apply the legislation in an independent way.
At this point, welcome Fergus Ewing, who's joined us. I explained why you were a little bit late with us this morning, Fergus, earlier. So good to see you with us now.
I apologise.
No, that's fine. When you said you pointed to the different skill sets that there are on the panel, do you decide these things collectively, or is it that there's a small quorum of people who are available in respect of different particular cases, or is it like a roundtable discussion with the kind of board, with the panel? Is, I mean, how many people is that?
And so our panel members, and we have 38 at the moment, are appointed by Scottish ministers through the public appointments process. We are involved in that process. It was our deputy chair, someone from our sponsor unit, who was involved in those interviews at the most recent round. Ministers appoint on the basis of criteria, and that would include their skills that they had. Those skills can be found in a number of different backgrounds, and because we're looking for independent decision makers, quite often they would have legal backgrounds, social work backgrounds, psychology and former police backgrounds. That pool of panel members are individually allocated to panel hearing days, and we would typically hear three or four individual applications in one day. Those panels are constituted of two or three panel members, and those panel members are chosen because of the difference they have. So, for example, we may have a lawyer, a clinical psychologist, a social worker, or two lawyers, a police officer, different compositions, and they would come together to consider that application in detail. We would receive the information several days, even weeks beforehand, and make careful individual considerations before those panel members came together and spent time very carefully thinking about what decision they have to make on the basis of all of the information that's been submitted.
And if an application bounces about a bit, is it the same core panel that would consider that, or would so that
applications or, wouldn't normally bounce
so it's
about.
Normally it no. normally comes and that's true.
No, it would be we're very thoughtful that some of the information in these applications is incredibly sensitive, and survivors may never have spoken about this before, so we use absolute confidentiality and the minimum number of people seeing this information
now,
would see it.
As you've just articulated it, I'm trying to understand why the First Minister would publicly pronounce that individuals weren't eligible if the process, as you've described it, is that the application comes to you and Redress Scotland makes that decision. Should it not more appropriately have been understood to be a decision of Redress Scotland and not, as it appeared to be from the way this unfolded, a determination of the First Minister, which was kind of then left as being of a higher standard than any consideration you might have given?
So there is no blanket rule to say that Fernethy survivors cannot apply to the redress scheme and be considered within Redress Scotland, and there are circumstances where that could be possible. The primary challenge around eligibility and the potential for Fernethy survivors to get an award are the eligibility requirements. So under the Act, there are four criteria that need to be met to be able to be considered for redress. So being a child who's experienced abuse in a residential or other care setting and before 2004. There is, however, regulation that was approved by Parliament which specifically excludes those who were in short-term care and where it was considered that parents had made arrangements for that short-term holiday respite care. Eligibility is the primary challenge to Fernethy survivors receiving redress, and we have to apply the Act and the regulations, otherwise we can be challenged in our independent decision making.
So we
could be challenged by Scottish ministers, so we have to follow the Act. That is clearly laid down in the Act, that we need to follow the rules that are laid down by Parliament. And if, for example, we made a decision that was not based on the Act, if we could be considered to have made a material error, and it could be sent back to us for reconsideration and potentially judicial review.
No, and here we've got slightly the nub, and I know I'll allow other colleagues to come in after this, but I think what we've been unable to completely understand is why, given that there are a number of criteria that you identified there, and quite specifically, these survivors were sent to Fernethy without proper consent from their parents, which appeared to be, in the criteria you identified, the last one of which there could be a discretion of consideration in respect of, why, given that they were sent there without true consent from their parents, that the criteria didn't allow for an application to be considered. And here's where I think we find it tricky. The Scottish Government then saying, that's your decision, not ours, which is almost to suggest they wouldn't have held you to account if you'd come to a decision that you wanted to give consideration to Fernethy. And it's this, it seems to me, circle of not quite landing on where the fact that a consideration can't take place is validated. So, I mean, given that the survivors were sent without demonstrable parental consent, why is that criteria not sufficient to allow for them to be considered within the scope of this?
Joanna, do you want to come specifically on that?
Yeah, so I think what's maybe helpful is to think through how decisions are actually made and what panel members work through. So every single application is considered on the basis of the individual facts and circumstances in that application. And it's for the survivor making that application to set out within it, this is the abuse that happened to me, here's the circumstances, and to give as much information as they can. The panel members then look at that and they will take into account whatever everything that they've been told within that application. So if that includes information about the circumstances by which they came to be in that placement, whatever type of placement it was, panel members will take that into account, particularly when they're looking at eligibility. So they will work through all of the aspects of eligibility, then use the assessment framework to assess that application if it's for an individually assessed application. What that means is it's open to a survivor of abuse to make the choice to apply to the scheme. So as far as we are concerned at Redress Scotland, there is not a blanket statement on any particular group of survivors or any particular set of circumstances, because what we do is we look at every individual application and make a decision for that individual on the basis of their experience in care and what happened there.
Okay, well, I think we're going to let David Torrance pursue this point.
David Torrance. Thank you, Convener, and good morning to witnesses. Just touching on what something was said earlier there, can you explain what evidence the FNAFI survivors have to show Redress Scotland to establish that exclusion for short-term respite or holiday care does not apply to their cases?
So I think that's a really difficult question to answer, because each individual application would be understood, would be considered on the basis of all of the information that was supplied. I think it would be difficult to give a tick box answer about what you would need to have in order to demonstrate that. But I think the point that Joanna made there around explaining the circumstances in which somebody were to have experienced short-term care would mean that we could consider that, the panel members could consider that and make an independent decision on the information that was sent.
Yeah, that please. A little. So the presumption of truth is what panel members work from. So they start with a presumption that every applicant has been as honest and as accurate as they're capable of being in their application. So I think that's a really important principle of the scheme and of the legislation. They then work on the balance of probabilities. Is this more likely to have happened than not? And they'll then work with whatever supporting information is available. And there's a whole range of different supporting information that we see within applications. It's highly dependent on the individual circumstances that that person has experienced. So you will appreciate that has been very challenging and difficult for many survivors to find information about what happened to them, the care settings they were in, what happened within those care settings. Records can be missing or limited. There's provision made for that within the statute of guidance, and the panel members can assess what information the survivor has been able to provide, look at the efforts that have been made to obtain that, and many survivors go to considerable efforts to try and work out where what's happened to the records, and then they can use their discretion at that point to make a determination of the application, to make a decision on eligibility and also if there's any redress to be made.
Could I just come in on that point about statutory guidance and documentation saying that the individual was, whether it be at FNAFI or any other establishment, what would they have to show to say that they were there if there was no legal documents saying they were there?
So in those kind of circumstances, what we would generally tend to see is that a survivor in their application would then explain the efforts they've gone to try and get that information. They might show evidence of subject access requests, they might show a letter they've written, they might show the response they've had from different organisations, and then they would say, I've made every effort but I've not been able to locate records for this. And in those circumstances, what the panel members would do is they would apply the presumption of truth, the balance of probabilities, read the survivor statement of abuse and reach a determination on the eligibility for that applicant.
Just on that balance of truth and probabilities, can you explain how that applies? Because I know some of the survivors are here today. And how would you go through that process?
So one of the processes we've designed at Redress Scotland is the way in which the panels actually run. And I think that's quite important because that's where we, if you like, bake in the presumption of truth, the balance of probabilities, and we work from our values of dignity, compassion and respect. So every application is considered on its individual merits. Panel members don't reach across into other applications or other experiences. It's absolutely focused on that individual. Panel members will talk about trying to keep the survivor in the room, so they're really thinking about that person. They start the panel with a statement about the values, dignity, respect and compassion. They talk about how that will be applied in this particular case. They remind each other of the balance of probabilities, the presumption of truth, and they use that as touchstones as they go through the process of determining that application. So they work through the different aspects of eligibility that they have to consider. They lean into whether they have to use their discretion and apply those principles depending on the application. And then they work through the four categories of abuse using the assessment framework in order to assess individually assessed applications. So it's a continuous process through all that discussion and the determination of the application. It's not a check-in at the end of a panel sitting, and it's not something where the panel members are filling in a bit of a form in advance. It's something they actually do in practice throughout that session, and they apply on an individual basis to application. One of the things we do at Redress Scotland is we have a quality assurance and improvement framework in place, and one of the things we do as part of that is we observe the panels working. There's a small number of us within the team and within the non-executives that observe panels, and what we're doing there is we're quality assuring the process. We're checking that that process that I've just described is actually happening in practice. So I can absolutely give an assurance that is what happens in practice, and that is very much the focus of panel members because of the quality assurance work we've done around that.
Thank you. I have no further questions.
Can I just... I still just don't want to quite lose sight of this issue of consent, because the research that Dr. Fossey put together really came to the view that there was no evidence of parental consent, at least no documented evidence. Have you come to the conclusion that there is?
I'm not sure we could answer that because we wouldn't necessarily have access to that information. So people may have... Can you ask your question again?
I'm interested to know, one of the criteria as you identified it was this issue of parental consent.
Mm.
In the absence of anything to demonstrate that there was parental consent, and Dr. Fossey can, in her report, demonstrating that there doesn't appear to be, then there is no evidence that parental consent was given. So how do you then determine parental consent was given in order not to apply that criteria of parental consent as being a legitimate reason for consideration?
Okay, so we would understand each individual application on the basis of the information that was given to us. So much as we may be aware, and we obviously have read the reports and keep ourselves abreast of developments and changes in the area, so we're aware of that document, but it would be for the panel to consider the information that was supplied by the applicant, by the survivor, and on the presumption of truth, if we are hearing from someone that this is what happened, then that's the information that we would be understanding and we would be considering making a decision using our values and on the balance of probabilities. But the presumption of truth is very important there for us. So if an individual survivor is telling us something, then although it's a rebuttable presumption, that's the basis on which we act. So any applicant coming to us would be considered on that basis.
Well, I suppose that's what I'm genuinely confused, because if there is a presumption of truth and there is no evidence to suggest that there was parental consent and they are saying there wasn't parental consent, then why aren't they being believed, since that would be a criteria that would have made them eligible?
So we absolutely would be wanting to believe applicants who came to us, and if a Farnethy survivor comes to us or any other survivor comes to us and has information that means that they can, that we can make a decision based in the legislation, then we would be doing that. There's no doubt the regulations make it more difficult because of the very specific exclusion, but both aspects of that regulation need to be met for there to be a denial.
Okay. Fergus Ewing?
Yes, thank you. Convener, how many cases have been turned down by Redress Scotland and why?
So only 4% of the applications that we have received in the last 2.5 years have been denied decisions. We make those with sadness, but it is a very low proportion. I couldn't tell you the reasons why. It's not information that we collate because of the nature of the work that we do.
Well, you know, we want to try to, I think, find out the facts. So it would be helpful if you're not prevented from telling us, if you could perhaps write to us, without naming names, to explain for what reason the 4% were turned down. I'm pleased to hear it's a small number, but I wanted really to focus on material that we've received from the Law Society of Scotland and from Thompson's solicitors. And I guess the problems, I think, arise from the guidance, perhaps from the Act itself and the exceptions from eligibility and the guidance. And, I mean, the Law Society put it quite clearly that it's unfortunate, that's a sort of lawyerly euphemism. It's a bloody disgrace, in my opinion. But anyway, they say it's unfortunate for this particular group that access to the scheme is based on who decided to place the child into care in the short or longer term and does not take into account whether the abuse took place at an emanation of the state. So this question of whether or not the placement was voluntary or involuntary seems to me to be completely irrelevant. Wouldn't you agree with that? That, I mean, if a child was placed in the care of the state, in loco parentis, that child is abused. It doesn't really matter what the intention was of the person that put the child there, surely. I mean, I don't want to put you in the spot, but just as a sort of human being, would you not agree with that proposition that this criteria is just insupportable?
So I may well have a personal position on that. Yeah. I think as the Chair of Redress Scotland, it would be inappropriate for me to express a personal view. A human view would be absolutely, I understand the proposition that you're making, that the individual survivor had no say in who put them in and may not even know what the circumstances were, given that they were a child at the time. What we have to do in our decision-making is make the decision on the basis of the information that's supplied and in relevance to the legislation.
Yes. Well, I'm pleased that you've been candid, and I do understand that Redress Scotland is a creature of statute, so that governs how you behave. So it's not any personal criticism at all. I think that really gets to the nub of it, as far as I can see, Convener, because, you know, whereas we have had evidence from Professor McArdle, I think, that in some cases, really, parents didn't have any choice about whether their children were placed there or not. In one sense, it seems to me that should be irrelevant. If a child is abused at the hands of an institution which is effectively in loco parentis and under control of the state must compensate. And I think since the witnesses agree with that, Convener, it does seem to me that the case for recommending that the guidance be altered in accordance with the Law Society and Thompson's advice seems to me to be a no-brainer. So I don't think there's any need for any more questions.
Thank you, Mr. Ewing. Mr. Chowdhury.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I just want some clarification. If a case is refused or if the case is not heard, do you have any examples of the evidences that will be acceptable? Do you have a list of the evidences can be accepted.
So that's laid out in the legislation about what supporting information we can consider. Joanna touched on some of that list. So it is broad and expansive, the information that we would consider. And it could be informal records. It may be much less formal than that, because we are aware that very large numbers of survivors have difficulties in getting supporting information about the circumstances in which they were in care and how those processes took place. Would you like to
say a little bit more about that? So the application that the survivor makes is very much their application. They finalise it, they write their own statement of abuse, they can write that in any form that suits them. In fact, they can record a film of themselves talking as their statement of abuse and send that as part of their application. So it's absolutely open for any survivor applying to the scheme to put together their application in the way that they see fit and proper and that works for them. And I think that's a really important point there. What that means for us at Redress Scotland is we will accept whatever information we are sent as part of that survivor's application, and that the panel members will read every line and go through every page that they are supplied with, whether that's 50 pages or 1,500 pages, and that's the range we actually see in applications. In terms of supporting information, where a survivor is applying for an individually assessed payment, they also have to provide supporting information to support their statement of abuse, what happened to them. That is very open as well in many ways. So the kind of things we tend to see, which are also listed in the statutory guidance, are statements from family and friends, information from people that were in the same institution at the same time, medical professionals, people in the helping professions will also provide information. And again, there's some discretion there for panel members in that they can make a decision about what they take into account. So it's very open, I would say, for survivors, for applicants to decide what they want to include. And we take a very kind of open, value-based view on that. Part of it is, of course, accepting that it is really difficult for survivors to get this kind of information. Records were not kept of what happened at the time on a regular basis. So in the present day, we've got to recognise that, and there's got to be an openness to what can be realistically provided and an acceptance that that has to be looked at and weighed with everything else with the application.
Yeah, that, just one more. My colleagues touched on that. The question I was going to ask you is, do Redress Scotland agree with the former Deputy First Minister that the Fornetti survivor would meet the evidential requirement even if the scheme was extended? So do you agree to that?
So our view would be that there's a wide range of information that could be sent that could help us meet the evidentiary requirements. We also have that ability to use discretion. Discretion is specifically there recognising that it can be incredibly difficult to get the information that of records because of their historic nature and because of the poor record keeping. So that discretion can be used, for example, if survivors have gone to extensive efforts and have made subject access requests and try to find other information to support that application. So there is the opportunity to use discretion. The guidance around evidentiary requirements is quite broad. So there's some flexibility in there for independent decision makers. It is, discretion can only be used in exceptional circumstances according to the legislation. So we would be keeping that in mind, but we can use it.
Can I ask you, anybody who watches one of these reconstructed TV dramas of some great injustice that took place decades ago, it usually involves somebody going to a warehouse in the middle of nowhere and turning on a light bulb, and there's a whole lot of boxes that have fallen apart with paper records that belong to a bygone era. How widespread is poor record keeping and evidence availability an issue in really all of the claims that maybe come before you of any kind of a historical nature? Because I think, you know, when the digital age came, a lot of people just put everything that was historical away and lost. And it was a long time before anybody thought, oh, maybe we should be transcribing these in some sort of format that would make them available for the future. Is this a commonplace occurrence?
So it's maybe worth saying that the Scottish Government, the Redress Division, are the caseworkers, are the group of individuals who would support a survivor to try to get hold of the information that they wanted to put in their application through subject access request, contacting councils, etc. Because of the requirement for as few people seeing individual applications, I in fact do not see that information, but Joanna may be able to give you more information on that basis.
Yeah, so I would say that there's a very wide variation. So some people are able to make a subject access request and retrieve extensive care records. Some people are able to retrieve very little. We may see circumstances where perhaps there's just a line saying somebody's been admitted to a particular institution, and we may see circumstances where records just aren't available here in the present day. So there's a very wide range. I would say panel members have developed a lot of skill and experience now in working with that range, and they will work with what's in front of them to as much as they can. Record keeping has progressed considerably over the decades. So the kind of record keeping that is being kept now by local authorities, voluntary organisations, is of a very different standard as it was from 20, 40, 60, 80 years ago. So we recognise that in the way that we work at Redress Scotland, and we recognise the difficulties facing survivors, particularly as you perhaps go further back into time.
Yes. Okay, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, convener. Dignity, respect and compassion appear to be severely lacking in this case, and I think the committee's trying to determine why and who is ultimately responsible, and if we can, in terms of the redress scheme, put right what once went wrong. And I'm just interested in terms of the actual system for assessing each individual case, because I think from the evidence we've heard today, it's actually a little bit more confusing in terms of some of the aspects you've mentioned, for example, exceptional circumstances, people in the same institution at a similar time acting as corroboration, and ultimately that balance of probability and the presumption of truth. Now, in this particular case, does the system allow for that kind of cross-corroboration, particularly where no records exist, rather than, if you like, the standard system where it's an individual case where there's no other similar cases, and therefore, you know, I accept everything you've said, but it seems as if that in this particular case that there should be either a slightly different system or some of the flexibilities which you've mentioned being brought in, and I'm unclear about that.
So those flexibilities absolutely would be brought in, and they are brought in. So we do use discretion, and we absolutely use the principle of truth first and foremost, and use our values in all aspects of our decision making and more widely in the organisation. It is fundamental to what we do. Joanna, do you want to say a little more?
Yeah, so panel members, when they're making decisions, are looking at the facts and circumstances of that individual case. So they will work through the eligibility requirements. If it's for a fixed, and if it's for an individual assessed payment rather than a fixed payment, they'll work through the assessment framework to then assess the correct level. In doing that, they can consider whatever has been presented to them by the survivor, particularly in relation to supporting information or where there's been records that haven't been available to be accessed. And they will do that on the facts and circumstances of each individual case. So there's the ability for the survivor making the application and their statement of abuse to set out why they were there, what happened, and any other information that they think is relevant for the panel members to see and to consider. And that, I think, leaves it open for the survivor to put together the application that they believe is correct for them, best represents their experience, and that can then be considered fully by the panel members. So your point about corroboration, if I can pick up on that. So I think it's really important to emphasise that the redress scheme is not litigation. It's not got the same parameters as civil or criminal action. In fact, it's specifically designed to provide a very different alternative to those types of actions. So panel members are not looking for corroboration in the sense that you might mean it in other settings. What they're looking for is supporting information that helps them reach the right decision for that particular application. So that means that they will accept a wide range of supporting information. So that could be actually from a spouse of a survivor, and the survivor's told them about what happened to them, but hasn't witnessed it. Panel members will, for example, accept that as supporting information for an individually assessed application. And they've got the ability to take a wide and a wide view based on the values and based on the presumption of truth.
Thanks for that. So just so I'm clear, if in terms of panel assessments, looking at individual cases, and if you know, in the case of Fernethy, but it could be applied to other cases, there is a number of individuals coming forward around the same location, and due to the constraints in terms of the guidance or in terms of the Act, the panel feels that they cannot provide redress in this case. But on the basis of humanity and doing what's right, they think that there should be something. Is there a process for flagging to the Scottish Government, Scottish ministers, that actually there's a problem here? Redress Scotland can't take it forward, but yourselves would like to resolve the issue? Is there any kind of conversations around that to ensure that those people who are victims get the justice and redress they deserve?
I think it's quite difficult to for us as an independent organisation who are making decisions to recommend a change in legislation to government. We apply the legislation and the regulations in the most compassionate, humane way we possibly can, and our panel members make those individual decisions. It is rare for us to deny, and we do give feedback to Scottish Government through our sponsor unit, but I'm not sure it would be our formal place to make recommendations around the legislation that feels more appropriate to panels such as this.
I think it's about for Redress Scotland to rewrite the rules or make recommendations, but I would think that it's Redress Scotland's role to flag concerns, and then it's up to civil service and Scottish ministers to say this is the recommendations based on that, or actually we don't think that. But I think unless, you know, whether it's in this case or others, unless there's a feedback loop, how will Scottish ministers know that there's potential issues or flaws in the legislation and the guidance?
So one of the things that we do when an application is determined is there's a letter that's written by the panel. And in that, they set out their decision, the reasons for that decision, and also there's a reflection of the abuse that the individual experienced. Whether it's a denied decision or an award redress decision, all of that's contained within the letter. That's then sent to the Scottish Government. So they are seeing and handling these letters as part of their case management. So they get information through that means. We also have an annual report and accounts that we do, and in that we report on our work. We talk about what we've actually done throughout the year, and we also highlight particular areas of work. We've certainly tried to do our first annual report, which was published late last year, on the basis of information that's useful and helpful for survivors, as well as for other people who have an interest in the work that we're doing. Within that report, we also have the ability to make recommendations, but that they would tend to be within the parameters that we have as an organisation, as an independent public body. And as Kirsty said, that would make it difficult for us to take up a position where we say this legislation, this regulation should be changed.
Okay, just final question. The Deputy First Minister appeared to suggest in evidence to this committee that a precedent could be set in the case of Fornethy survivors that might lead to a number of other cases. And I just wanted to get on the record from Redress Scotland that it doesn't matter to yourselves as an independent body whether a precedent is set in an individual case, whether that would mean hundreds or, heaven forbid, thousands of more cases were then set against that bar, that each individual case, and if there's wrongdoing, then it needs to be redressed. I'd just like to get that confirmation, if you can.
Yes, we absolutely would hear each individual case. Precedent isn't a phrase that we would use in our decision making at all. It is about the individual application and the individual survivor. If we were, for example, to receive an increase in the number of applications, and that has happened and is continuing to happen, we've had an increase in more than a third of the number of applications in the last few months. So it would not be unusual for us to experience an uplift in the number of applications. Inevitably, that does mean that the capacity of us as an organisation to make decisions is more challenging. People, survivors, may need to wait longer for those decisions. But if that were the case, and of course it is the case, that we then report back through our sponsor unit and into the minister to explain and to report on the length of time that people are waiting, and we would request more capacity and more funding to be able to hear those applications in what we would consider to be a reasonable length of time. But thanks. Yes, there would be implications for the scheme if we receive many more applications that we would need to then feed back so that funding decisions could be made.
Thank you, panel. Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much. Just two quick final questions from me. One is, obviously, given all the attendant publicity associated with this particular example, the scandal at Fornethy, and given your independent status, I'm just interested to know, has there been any endeavour by the Scottish Government to engage with you directly on the issues that have arisen in relation to Fornethy? And because you've talked, I think, here about what I would call formal reporting mechanisms, is that the chain of communication that's existed, or has there been any other level of communication that's taken place as a consequence of the attendant concern and publicity that's attached to this particular instance?
So I haven't had any formal conversations with Scottish ministers or our sponsor unit about Fornethy survivors.
I mean, there's certainly discussions at an operational level about all aspects of the scheme, but that tends to be on the basis of sharing information with each other. As you'll have seen from the legislation, there's a responsibility for both of us to collaborate with other and work together. So it's more in line with that rather than anything more.
And notwithstanding everything we've heard, could I just try to encapsulate in my own mind, if I was a Fornethy survivor and I believed that the circumstances that had placed me there were not freely determined by my parents, is that the basis for me to make a claim?
Each individual survivor needs to make that decision for themselves. The process of applying for redress and having to put this kind of information in a form and send it in can be a difficult and traumatising process. So that would need to be each individual survivor's decision. However, if a Fornethy survivor or any other survivor wanted to apply for redress and believe that they are potentially eligible, and you've given an example of when that might be the case, we absolutely would receive that application. We would consider it with great care, treat this application with our values, dignity, compassion and respect, allocate a panel and hear it and make a decision on that basis.
Thank you very much. And can I just say in conclusion, I think your own empathy with the position that people find themselves in is apparent in the evidence you've given this morning. So I'm very grateful to you for everything that you've volunteered to us. I think Mr. Ewing and the committee, as you've almost said, the responsibility maybe lies with us to be much more directional in our findings in these matters with the Scottish Government. But I'm very grateful to you for everything that you've volunteered with us this morning. Is there anything further that you would like to say that you feel hasn't managed to emerge during the course of the conversation that we've had?
No, I don't think so. Thank
okay.
you.
Well, in that case, thank you both very much. And we'll agree to hear the evidence later. And in the meantime, I suspend the meeting briefly just to allow everybody to settle. Thank you. Yeah, we're back. Thank you very much. And we are now proceeding with the continuing petitions that we have. And the next of those petitions is petition number 1877 to provide body cameras for all frontline NHS staff. And this has been lodged by Alex Wallace, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide body cameras for all frontline NHS staff and paramedics in Scotland. At our last consideration of this petition, we agreed to write to the Scottish Ambulance Service to request information about the outcome of its evaluation of trial body cameras. Now, the Scottish Ambulance response explains that a plan was being developed to trial body camera equipment. However, it actually didn't progress to a live trial due to staff concerns. The submission states that the full purchase and rollout of equipment would likely attract a capital cost in excess of 1.5 million and a recurring annual cost of around £400,000. And as a result of the cost and staff concerns, the work on body cameras has therefore been paused by the Scottish Ambulance Service. In the light of that, I wonder what members feel we might consider. Mr. Ewing.
Well, on the face of it, there is a case perhaps for closing, but I just wanted to check something which occurred to me when reading the papers, which is really whether, I hear what the Scottish Ambulance Service say, that the staff are reluctant to support it because they don't want to have body cameras. I can understand that, but I just kind of wonder if we, rather than just take that as a given, whether we have had from the petitioner himself a response to this, because I think recent history is littered with examples of where ministers, but perhaps parliamentarians as well as ministers, just accept willy-nilly a statement made by leaders of a public body, e.g. the post office, without actually testing it very much. So I wonder whether it might be expedient, if we haven't heard from Mr. Wallace, to ask whether he's in agreement with that, and If he is, then I would have thought that's the end of the issue. I don't think the finance is perhaps such a telling issue because, I mean, if cameras were effective in stopping assaults, then these amounts of money are insignificant. They could perhaps stop a death, an attack, or they could minimise the consequences of an attack. So
I can't say that Mr. Wallace hasn't responded. I mean, he obviously is aware of the submissions that we've received and has had the opportunity to make a further submission, but has chosen not to. I'm slightly reluctant to establish a precedent that a petitioner doesn't come back responding to the other evidence we've heard, that we will then actively solicit a further response, but I don't think that's our normal practice.
No. Well, if the clerks are saying that he's seen the Scottish Ambulance submission, then he has had an opportunity to respond. So that would.
That is the case.
Yeah, that is the case.
Well, if that's the case, then I think my point has been answered, because if he was dissatisfied,
he would have had the opportunity.
He has had the opportunity to speak, and that's. That's really what I was.
In which case, are you moving under Rule 15.7 of standing orders?
Yes, for that reason.
Okay, so we will close the petition on the basis that Scottish Ambulance Service has, in fact, paused its work due to the reluctance of staff support to support the rollout, which we place a greater premium on than necessarily the financial implications that were also identified. Would that be fair? And I think, just to satisfy Mr. Ewing, I think we would say that it would be open to the petitioner at a later date, if the situation he feels warrants this pause being re-examined, to submit a further petition at that time. That brings us to petition number 1902, to allow an appeal process for community participation requests. This has been lodged by Maria Aitken on behalf of the Caithness Health Action Team. And it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to allow an appeal process for community participation requests under the Community Empowerment Act 2015. And we last considered this petition on the 4th of October last, although it's very vivid in my mind that we did. Now, while we would not ordinarily intervene in the individual case that prompted a petition, our parliamentary colleague Edward Mountain suggested that we pursue this issue directly, and we have now received a response. And the response from NHS Highland is available in the meeting papers, and in the light of that response having been received, do I have any suggestions for action from the committee? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. In light of evidence, I wonder if the committee would consider closing the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standard Orders, on the basis that the Scottish Community Development Centre is currently working on proposals for participation request appeals process as part of the Scottish Government's Review of Community Empowerment Scotland Act 2015. And NHS Highland has explained its decision to the Caithness Health Action Team and is open to a resubmission for community participation or continued informal engagement. In closing the petition, I wonder if the committee could add that if a petitioner is not satisfied with the outcome of the Scottish Government's review, a further petition could be brought in a year's time.
Thank you, Mr. Torrance. Colleagues, are you content to support Mr. Torrance's suggestion? You are. Thank you. So we will close the petition on that basis, and thank Maria Aitken for having raised the issue here in Parliament. Petition number 1976, to backdate council tax discounts for dementia to the date of GP certification. And this is a petition that is continuing, having been lodged by Derek James Brown, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to require council tax discounts to be backdated to the date a person was certified as being severely mentally impaired, where they then go on to qualify for a relevant benefit. And again, we discussed this petition last autumn on the 20th of September, and we agreed then to write to the Scottish Government. The response states that a draft severe mental impairment application form was presented to COSLA in an effort to encourage all local authorities to adopt a common approach to administering council tax exemptions for people suffering from severe mental impairment. Officials are now actually continuing to engage with COSLA on this issue. Alzheimer Scotland's submission states its view that the requirement for applicants to be eligible for a qualifying benefit is unfair and unnecessary, and they advocate for the Scottish Government to remedy this. Do members have any suggestions as to how we might proceed on this petition? Mr. Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if a committee would consider writing to the Scottish Government to ask whether it has explored the possibility of removing the requirement for an individual to be eligible for a qualifying benefit in order to receive a council tax exemption on the basis of severe mental impairment.
Thank you. I mean, this is a petition that I think attracted our attention when we first heard it, and we agreed on the follow-up action. We are. The next petition is petition number 2022 to introduce national safeguarding guidance on how higher education institutions should handle cases of sexual misconduct. This is a petition lodged by Ellie Wilson, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce national safeguarding guidance for dealing with cases of sexual misconduct in higher education institutions, which clearly involves, which includes clearly defined measures, to ensure campus safety where a convicted sex offender or someone awaiting trial for a serious sexual offence is enrolled in that institution. It's actually almost a year, June last, that we considered this petition, when we agreed then to write to Emily Test, Victim Support Scotland, University Scotland, Scottish Women's Aid, Rape Crisis Scotland, NUS Scotland and the Glasgow University Students' Representative Council. And the committee has received responses from Rape Crisis Scotland, Emily Test, Victim Support Scotland and Scottish Women's Aid in support of the petition. Many of the responses note the importance of having sector-wide guidance in place to ensure a consistent approach to protecting students is taken by all universities and colleges in Scotland. We've also received a submission from Universities Scotland, which details the work that is underway. This is to develop and deliver a consistent nationwide approach to data collection on convictions and criminal charges for students. Their response also highlights the importance of education as a tool for rehabilitation, noting the intention to keep data collection separate from the admissions process so as not to deter applications from people who pose no threat to other students. So again, an interesting petition, a considerable amount of submissions offered to us to help us in our evaluation. It does seem work is currently underway. Are you, Mr. Chowdhury?
Yeah, I think we should write to the Minister of for Higher and Further Education to highlight the evidences the committee has gathered and seek an update on the progress to develop a consistent approach to data collection and safeguarding that will help protect students.
Mr. Torrance?
I would like the committee, in light of evidence, I'm not saying we can't not write to the Minister for Higher Education, but in light of evidence that the committee has received, I'd like to close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that work is underway to develop a consistent nationwide approach to a collection of data relating to relevant criminal convictions and criminal charges from students, with University of Scotland working closely with stakeholders in the Scottish Government's Equality Safe and Colleges and Universities Co-Leadership Group to progress the work. In closing the petition, the committee will wish to write to Education, Children and Young People's Committee to highlight the petition and ask that the evidence it has gathered is taken into consideration as part of our work, including the Qualities and Safety Strategy.
Right, well, that's a bit different. Do you think we could combine these two proposals in some way? Might it be possible for us, in closing the petition, to take forward Mr. Chowdhury's recommendation that we write to the Minister for Higher Education, drawing the evidence that we've received and encouraging them in the work that we are doing? Would that satisfy Mr. Chowdhury, do you think?
Yeah, it should, but should we not wait until the University of Scotland have updated us in October 2024? Because we are... there is... University of Scotland.
Well, can I just draw members' attention, of course, you will also have on your table this morning a late submission from University of Scotland, and in this they do actually confirm they are taking this work forward. So we've got a very clear steer that the aims of the petition are probably now being realised through the action. I must admit I forgot that we had that just right. Sitting here. Does that perhaps satisfy the requirement, Mr. Chowdhury? Do you think?
Yes, it does, yeah.
So can we...
we should still write to the...
Can we combine Mr. Chowdhury's suggestion that we write to ministers while closing petition? Would that meet the approval of the committee this morning? It would. That's fine. Thank you very much. That brings us to petition number 2032, which is to improve the support available to injured soldiers and veterans in Scotland, lodged by James Brebner, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to improve the support provided by public bodies to injured soldiers and veterans in Scotland through the following series of actions, ensuring there are clear patient pathways for their injuries to be treated by appropriate consultants, establishing a veterans trauma network similar to that which operates in England and Wales, ensuring all correspondence raising concerns or making complaints about the treatment from veterans to the Scottish Government is acknowledged and responded to, and by reviewing and seeking an update the way in which the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman handles complaints from veterans about the health service. Now, we last considered this petition on October 4th when we agreed to write to the Scottish Government. The Scottish Parliament cross-party group on Armed Forces and Veterans Community, which I think some of us may sit on, the Armed Forces Personnel and Veterans, so I just make a joint declaration on behalf of all members of the committee who might sit on that committee. I do, I think Mr. Golden does. Is anybody else on the Veterans Committee? Just so we've got that out there, that's fine. The Armed Forces Personnel and Veterans Joint Group, Veterans Scotland, the Armed Forces Charity, SSAFA, and the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman. The cross-party group, as I say, supported by Mr. Golden, have responded to highlight that the first ask of the petition has been delivered through the Veterans Welfare and Defence Transition Service, while the establishment of veterans trauma networks similar to that which operates in England and Wales is also being progressed, with the Scottish Veterans Treatment Pathway expected to be introduced during the course of this year. In line with information provided to the cross-party group, the Armed Forces Personnel and Veterans Joint Group have confirmed it has engaged extensively with NHS England in this matter and anticipates the treatment pathway will be delivered in 2024. Now, we've also received a response from Scottish Public Services Ombudsman noting that complainants are not required to disclose their veteran status, and as such, the low numbers of complaints from self-declared veterans is not enough for the SPSO to draw out any themes or conclusions about which services veterans may be engaging with. And the Ombudsman does support efforts to improve how complaints to or about public bodies are responded to across Scotland, across the board, noting that the SPSO has recently updated its own guidance and vulnerability. Also, the committee has received a response from the Scottish Government confirming that during the course of 2023, 75% of items classified as ministerial correspondence were responded to within 20 working days, with efforts underway to increase the proportion of correspondence responded to within this time frame. So actually, from the cross-party group and from the other organisations who've responded, significant aspects of the aims of the petition are underway and hopefully delivered during the course of this year. In the light of that, are there any suggestions from colleagues? Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder, in light of the aims of the petition being sought and the progress is underway, I wonder if we could close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that it has been confirmed that the Scottish Veterans Treatment Pathway will closely replicate NHS England's Veterans Trauma Network, with the pathway expected to be introduced in 2004. And the SPSO supports the view that is useful for public bodies to review response times to identify general improvements for the benefit of everyone who engages with them, with the SPSO having recently updated its own guidance on vulnerability. I wonder also if the committee can just write to the Minister for Veterans to seek an update on the timescales for introducing Scottish Veterans Treatment Pathways.
Yes, I think we probably can. So in closing the petition, we will just ask the Minister if he can confirm that that is all on schedule, I think, or that the committee expects it to all be on schedule, and that is the basis on which we've chosen to close the petition, maybe put it that way. That brings us to item three in the agenda, which is the consideration of new petitions. That was the last of our continuing ones just then. And before we do so, I just for the record, because there may be people who are joining us or who are watching online to hear their petition considered for the first time, to explain that ahead of its first consideration here in committee, we take two initial actions. We ask the Scottish Government for an initial view, and we also invite the Scottish Parliament's independent research body, SPICE, to comment on the aims of the petition. And you may ask why we do that. We do that because previously If we hadn't done that, then at the first meeting, those are the two things we agreed to do, and it simply delayed the progress of the petition. So we consider it, with members having received that early indication from both the Scottish Government and from the Parliament's independent research body, who, as I've said before, do tremendous work on behalf of this committee, given the enormously broad range of petitions that we hear. Petition number 2083, therefore, is to review the rules to ensure that no dog becomes more dangerous as a result of breed-specific regulations. And this has been lodged by Katrina Gordon, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to review the Dangerous Dogs Designated Types Scotland Order 2024 and ensure that breed-specific regulations do not restrict responsible dog owners from undertaking exercise and training routines which supports the dog's welfare and reduce the risk of their dog becoming dangerous. The petitioner tells us that an XL bully dog requires 2 hours of outdoor exercise per day, including being able to run off lead, in order for the dog to be well adjusted and remain under its owner's control. It is the petitioner's view that recently introduced rules requiring XL bully dogs to be on lead and muzzled while in public spaces risks making these dogs more dangerous. The Spice briefing draws our attention to the Minister for Agriculture and Connectivity's contribution during the Stage 1 debate on the Welfare of Dogs Scotland Bill, announcing the government's intention to hold a responsible dog ownership and control summit later this month. The briefing also notes one of the criticisms of the new restrictions being that they do nothing to address the issue of dog attacks that take place in private spaces, a point which Christine Graham, MSP, raised during the Criminal Justices Committee's consideration of the SSI and the motion to annul. The Scottish Government's response to the petition states that it understands the concerns expressed by dog owners about the impact the new controls may have on their dogs. However, there is a balance to be struck between protecting animal welfare and protecting public safety. It is the government's view that allowing an owner to exercise their dog in a public space while off lead and without a muzzle would be counterproductive to the aim of the regulations and would create too great a risk to the public. Now, we've also received two further submissions from the petitioner sharing her own experience and wider research on the negative impacts these restrictions have on the welfare of dogs and indeed their owners, potentially making these dogs more dangerous. And noting again also that these rules may have unintended consequence of increasing the number of dog attacks in people's homes and gardens, the petitioner has repeated her call for the rules to be repealed. So obviously an issue very much in the public eye, also an issue where there is some court action, which means we are unable to go into any specific discussion of any individual cases. But are there any suggestions as to how we might proceed? Mr. Golden.
Thanks, convener. I think there's quite a lot in this that would be helpful to follow up with the Scottish Government. I think it's important that the committee notes there's no such breed as an XL bully. It's the characteristics and type that have been subject to restrictions, which might be something to follow up in terms of the verification of those characteristics, the capacity of vets and other professionals to have the ability to do that. I think as well it's important to ask the Scottish Government, for example, what training they are providing for owners to progress their dog to wearing a muzzle, for example, which is one of the restrictions. And in addition to that, I think we should find out and seek further details on the planned summit on responsible dog ownership and control, and specifically whether this will include owners of XL bully type dogs and provide the opportunity to consider the impact of the regulations on those owners, but also what other measures might be put in place by the Scottish Government to ensure more responsible ownership and ultimately welfare of dogs as well.
Well, thank you, Mr. Golden. I know you've concerned yourself with animal welfare issues relating to dogs before, the electric shock dog collars, I seem to recall in particular. So thank you for those suggestions. Are colleagues content to proceed to keep the petition open and to make the inquiries as suggested by Mr. Goldham?
Agreed.
We are. Thank you. That brings us to petition number 2088, which is a new petition to help eliminate cervical cancer through improved and at-home HPV testing. And this is lodged by Emma Keyes, and I believe we may have the petitioner and supporters of the petition with us in the gallery this morning. So welcome to you. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to help eliminate cervical cancer for women and those with a cervix in Scotland by introducing at-home HPV, human papillomavirus, self-sampling to enhance the smear testing programme, helping to increase the uptake and accessibility of smear testing. We're joined by one of our faithful attendees from amongst our MSP colleagues, Monica Lennon, MSP. Good morning to you, Monica, and in a moment I may invite you to address the committee. As referenced in the SPICE briefing, the Cancer Incidence Report from Public Health Scotland notes that the drop in the early detection of cervical cancers in 2020 is unfortunately most likely due to the pause in screening services during the pandemic. The briefing also highlights that women from deprived backgrounds are less likely to participate in screening, going on to note that self-testing is seen as a way of getting round some of the barriers to smear testing. Self-testing has been trialled in some areas of England and in Dumfries and Galloway. In response to the petition, the Scottish Government states that it relies on advice from the UK National Screening Committee, and whilst that committee recognises the potential benefits of self-sampling, it has previously concluded there is insufficient evidence to recommend implementation, and studies underway to gather further evidence, which are expected to conclude shortly if they have not already done so. The Scottish Government, however, do acknowledge the potential self-sampling has to increase uptake levels and reduce barriers to cervical screening. As such, a working group has been convened to assess potential models and to understand any required changes to the screening programme to support an initial rollout, following emerging evidence from global studies, including the one to which I referred a moment ago in Dumfries and Galloway. So those are the comments we've received from SPICE and from the Scottish Government. And Monica Lennon, if very much welcome any thoughts or comments you might have for the committee as well.
Thank you, Convener. It's always a pleasure to attend the committee, and I'm pleased I can speak in support of the petition today by Emma Keyes. I know a lot of work has gone into this to get it to this point, and I'm really grateful to SPICE as well. It's a really excellent briefing, and the fact it also sets out that self-sampling is already common in countries like the Netherlands and Australia. I would say that in addition to the work happening in England and elsewhere in the UK, we also have international experience to learn from. But I think it's just important to take a moment to remember why we're here and why the petition is so necessary. We know that hundreds of people are diagnosed with cervical cancer in Scotland every year, and sadly that results in many people losing their lives. And figures that we have from Joe's Cervical Cancer Trust for 2023, that around 95 people had died, the most recent figures. I'd also like to pay tribute to Joe's Trust. Sadly, the charity has recently had to wind down for other reasons we won't go into here today, but I know that colleagues know how much they have done to raise awareness of symptoms, but also about the treatments and the potential that we have to prevent this disease. And that's a message of hope today. So we know that the World Health Organization has called for countries to come together to eliminate the disease. And last year, I was really pleased to hear NHS England pledge to eliminate cervical cancer by 2040. And setting out how that could be done, the NHS England Chief Executive Amanda Pritchard outlined how the health service can help achieve the goal of elimination by making it easier, or as easy as possible, for people to get the life-saving human papillomavirus or HPV vaccination and to increase cervical cancer screening uptake. This is really important because we know that HPV virus causes up to 99% of cervical cancers. So the vaccination plus screening plus self-sampling gives us an array of tools that we can use. So we know that in England, self-sampling is being trialled to determine if it should be part of a national screening programme. And the message I think that campaigners want to send is that please don't delay. You know, if you get that invite or that opportunity to have screening, please take it. It can save your life. But we also know that for women and people with a cervix who don't take up that offer of screening, sadly, the opportunity can be missed because cervical cancer often causes no symptoms in its early stages. Self-sampling has been identified as a factor that could support the realisation of the World Health Organization cervical cancer elimination goals. But today as ever, you know, there's always a human story behind these petitions. So I do want to pay tribute to my constituent, Emma Keyes, who is sitting behind me in the gallery today. Emma is a young mum from Uddingston in Lanarkshire, and she experienced a shock cervical cancer diagnosis at the age of 29. And that would have been debilitating and shocking for many people. But Emma's chosen to use her experience to raise awareness, to help women and to save lives. And Emma's message is cervical cancer is preventable. She's become a bit of an icon online. She's known on social media as Mrs. Smear. And I think it's really important. And for us as politicians, we sometimes think we're the best message carrier, but Emma can speak to an audience in our community that we can't always get the attention of. It's got not just women talking, but partners, employers, friends and neighbours and families. So that communication piece is really important because there are many, many barriers. But the petition is more about, it's not just about raising awareness, it's about much more than that. It's about making sure our healthcare systems are fit for purpose, that we eliminate barriers to healthcare. The HPV self-sampling trial in Dumfries and Galloway, I know went very well. I know that one of the MSPs in that region, Emma, I've now blanked out on Emma's name, Emma Harper. Apologies to Emma Harper. This will now be on the record. I'll say it again, Emma Harper. I know that Emma, given her background in nursing as well, was very passionate about that. Emma Keyes and I have met with two different public health and women's health ministers, and I want to thank Marie Todd and Jenny Minto. It's really good that the Scottish government is looking to take advice from the UK body that was mentioned, the National Screening Committee, but we also need to work at pace on this. So again, it's about looking at not just experience in the UK, but around the world as well. So that pilot scheme was really important. I know the pandemic has set back a number of initiatives, and the convener talked about the year during the pandemic when we saw you know, the number of cases diagnosed going down, but that was because of a lack of screening. And just to say, you know, this committee's got a really strong record on championing women's health. I think that's best evidenced in the committee's role in advancing truth and justice for mesh injured women. We've got a real opportunity in this parliament to really pick up that challenge that's been set by the World Health Organization, and to really show that Scotland's got the expertise and the knowledge, but not to sit back and wait too long to get the wheels in motion. So I want to end by reiterating my support for Emma Keyes, for her petition, for her campaign. I know that Emma, as a cervical cancer survivor, at one point feared that she wouldn't live to see her three children grow up. Thankfully, due to our amazing NHS and Emma's tenacity, she's here to fight and to show others that even with a dark diagnosis, there is hope. But the lesson that Emma has taught all of us is that we can prevent and eliminate cervical cancer if we use all the tools available to us. And that's what the petition's about today. So I'd like to thank the committee for looking at this and hope we can discuss it again in the future. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Monica Lennon, for that contribution to the aims of the petition. And yes, very much a heartfelt tribute on behalf of your constituent who is the petitioner. You're quite right. And this committee, I think over the years, has been very fortunate. The number of courageous people who've come forward on the back of their own experience to lodge a petition, which this committee has been able to give additional voice to the aims of and profile and take forward. And I think, you know, of the long list, you alluded to Elaine Holmes and Olive McElroy in relation to Mesh, but also Amanda Capel, who successfully saw changes to legislation in support for those diagnosed early with dementia, and our own former colleague Elaine Smith, who I remember was very proactive in relation to issues relating to women's health with this committee as well, taking forward those issues. So I can say to the petitioner, you are in excellent company in terms of women who have been at the forefront of ensuring that we are able to take forward and advance issues which have seen a material change in the way the Scottish Government and Scottish public life approaches them. And in the light of that, I certainly think we should be writing to the UK National Screening Committee to seek an update on its work to gather further evidence on the benefits of HPV self-sampling, including work to assess and validate a test for HPV self-sampling in the UK. Are there any other suggestions from colleagues? Mr. Torrens.
I just wonder if we could also write to the Scottish Government to seek an update on a working group that has been established to assess potential models and understand any required changes to the screening programme to support the initial rollout of HPV self-sampling. It's something which Monica Lennon has highlighted as really important, and my better half just lost a cousin at the age of 39 last Friday to it. I know how important it is to get sampling done and get tested for it. So.
On which note, are colleagues content to act in the way that we've done? So thank you very much to the petitioner and to Monica Lennon. The petition will be held open and we will advance the aims of it. Oh, sorry, Faisal. Apologies.
I just wanted to add that can we also try to find out what is the barriers who are preventing women from various communities to take the cervical screening?
Yes.
Is there a way we can...
We could do that too. No, we'll seek to...
That data.
Who would be the best body, do we think, for that? We'll incorporate that into the request to the Scottish Government and see whether they can give further insight into that matter too. So with the addition of Mr. Faisal's suggestion relating to seeking to establish why people are faced by barriers, are we content? We are. Thank you all very much. That brings us to petition number 2089, much anticipated by members of the committee, a petition to stop more national parks in Scotland. Lodged by the Deborah Carmichael on behalf of the Lochaber National Park No More Group. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to suspend any action to create further national parks in Scotland, to instruct an independent review on the operation of the current national parks, including assessment of the economic impacts on businesses and industries within the two parks, including but not exclusive to farming, forestry, crofting and angling, and to conduct a consultation with representatives of rural businesses and with their community councils in order to help frame the remit of this said independent review. Because in responding to the petition, the Scottish Government note that the appraisal phase for the new national park has concluded and that the report is due out imminently this summer. They add that they have consulted local communities throughout the process and that further consultation will take place when the new national park process moves on to its reporter phase. They also point to evidence that existing national parks support thriving local economies, help to manage millions of visitors and to protect the national environment for the benefit of current and future generations. This includes 25 projects across the Cairngorms National Park, and the £450 million that was generated in the local economy in 2022 through visitor and tourism businesses in Loch Lomond and the Trossachs National Park. Now, in response, the petitioner raised concerns that the Scottish Government appears not to have acknowledged the widespread, and I quote, and well-documented problems associated with the existing two national parks, and reiterates her call for an independent review of national parks to take place before a new park is created, especially given that no review has been conducted in the 21 years since the current national parks were created. The petitioner states that in the current national park areas, landowners and farmers are increasingly concerned about overregulation and the needs of those who look after the land being dismissed. So I wonder if colleague Mr. Ewing.
Yes, thank you, Convener. I should start by just declaring that I live in Cairngorm National Park. I used to live within Loch Lomond National Park, actually. And I have previously supported a petition relating to the creation of a marine national park back in 2006 when it came before this committee as it was then. And I have been working with the petitioners in this issue generally, and I just wanted to put that on the record so that it's clear.
So done.
The key ask here is that logically, before you create new bodies, you should have an independent review about how the existing bodies are performing. I think logically that's a fairly strong argument, and that review should be independent, and that the review should be conducted after a careful thought is given to the remit, and that a number of people should be consulted about that. So I make no bones about it. I think that's logical, desirable, and something that really should take place. What I wanted to say was that, as far as I can see from my reading of the Scottish Government's response, it's two pages, but there is no response whatsoever to this argument. And I find that quite shocking, actually. And I'm bound to reflect that it's not the first time this has happened. And I do reflect that I think the Permanent Secretary should be asked to have a look at these responses before they come to a committee, because it's surely quite insulting where the main thesis, as I've outlined, is simply not addressed at all. I mean, the only bit I could find that remotely approached it was the last paragraph, an overview of the performance of the National Park Authorities as provided annually through their published annual report. Well, that's their own document. So, yes, the annual report does create a statement about what has been done during the year, but it's by no means independent in any way, nor can it ever be professed as such. So this reply is completely and utterly irrelevant. And that I find, I mean, irrespective of the fact that I have a clear position on this, I think as a committee we should be concerned about getting irrelevant documents from the Scottish Government instead of a reasoned argument about why they think this is not appropriate. There's lots of other points I could make, but just one substantial point, if I may. In the petitioner's response of the 4th of September, in paragraph 9, they point to a recent opinion poll that was conducted in Aviemore by the Community Forum online. I think 444 votes were cast on the basis that the park was not working well, and 10 votes, a paltry 3% of locals there, local residents, felt the park was performing well. I'm quite fond of referenda, and I would quite like to get 96% in a referenda, although not. But I think this really does show that the presentation we've had from the Scottish Government, that all is well in the garden, all the good things that result of the national park, rather than people's hard-working efforts, is just not the case at all. And I just thought I'd mention that for the sake of balance, because there isn't any in the Scottish Government's response. So, I think the options for action I would advocate to my committee members are threefold. One, firstly, to write to the Scottish Government to draw attention of the remarks that have been made.
How would you like that, the text of that approach, how strong would you like that to be worded, I think, Mr. Young?
Well, I personally, I mean, this is a committee, and I've got strong views, and other members may have different views, and I accept that.
Because, I mean, I take your point the Scottish Government didn't really address the issues of the petition in their initial response.
Yes.
And I also take your point that drawing attention to the Scottish Government's own homework as evidence of anything would be surprising if it came back and said that they didn't think that they had been doing a good job, or that the whole thing wasn't a stunning success, because that tends to be what government reports on their own homework do. So there isn't anything particularly independent in the character of that. So are we minded to be quite, I mean, would you like us to, would the to suggest the committee that we'd be quite kind of strong in the recommendation that they respond seriously to the issue that the petitioners raised of an independent voice being appointed to conduct a review of this?
Yes, and I think it's in their own interests, because if an independent review is conducted, convener, and it comes back with a positive outcome, then, you know, people like me would be bound to act on the basis of evidence should that occur. I mean, I don't think it will, but if it did occur, then, and it was a genuine independent review, that would strengthen their position to argue for more national parks. But a complete absence of an independent review seems to me to be a complete gap and lack of logic in creating a new body, particularly when it costs a lot of money. And people in Lochaber have said that they want a new hospital. They don't want a new national park. They want the Belford Hospital. So I think the two suggestions that are before us that should be taken up, that we should write in strong terms, as you've suggested, Convener, to ask the Scottish Government whether after 21 years of national parks, they will arrange for an independent review in the terms set out by the petitioner. And secondly, the other question is of consent and how the Scottish Government will verify evidence provided to it in new national park proposals, particularly with regard to the levels of local support and community engagement, because the petitioners argue that there is strong opposition in Lochaber and elsewhere. The NFU has come out against national parks, which is somewhat unusual for the NFU to be so clear, and that's significant. And I gather that in opinion polls taken amongst farmers in places which were candidates, such as Skye, in a meeting of over 100 farmers, every single one of them, farmers and crofters, every single one of them was against the national park. So the last point I'd make, Convener, is that, you know, I do also think we should hear evidence from the petitioners so that they, in their own words, can describe it. And I know that Deborah Carmichael and Ian McKinnon are friends of mine, and I think they and I think one other have got a very strong case to hear. And it's right, I think, that they be heard, because, you know, I fear that whatever we say, the government seem hell-bent on this process, no matter what. And therefore, we need to give a voice to people whose voice has been ignored thus far, to the extent that their arguments have been just completely ignored in the government response we've had. So I'm sorry to go on at such length to colleagues. I seek your discretion because of the obvious interest I have in this matter.
I also note 78% of land managers in Perth and Kinross were against. And, of course, probably at the moment, the issue that is most in the mind of many people in terms of attraction is the issue of the Flamingoland Park, which is being proposed within the national park there. And something like, I think, 94,000 people have objected, and people then wonder just exactly, well, what is the basis of the national park? And I suppose it's open to this committee through our interrogation of other witnesses beyond even the petitioners to potentially establish some independent assessment of how these matters are progressing. Are colleagues content to write to the Scottish Government in the first instance on the basis that Mr. Ewing has suggested?
Agreed.
We are agreed. We are. So we will keep the petition open. We thank the petitioners for raising it, and we will proceed in the first instance potentially expect this might be an issue on which we take further evidence later in the year. That brings us to petition number 2090, which is update the legislation granting permission for digital display boards. This has been lodged by Stephen Henson. I gather we obviously had some people specially attending to hear the petition in National Park, so thank you very much for being with us this morning. This has been lodged by Stephen Henson, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to update the Town and Country Planning Control of Advertisements Scotland Regulations 1984 to require the application for express consent to advertise using a digital display, including where a site has been upgraded from a traditional paper-based display. The despise briefing, we have received notes that large digital display boards are very likely to fall into the express consent category of planning regulations, meaning permission must be obtained before they can be installed. It's also noted that many local authorities already set limits on where digital advertising displays can be located. And responding to the petition, the Scottish Government details the requirements for notification of planning application for digital advertising, including the statutory requirement for a planning authority to notify in writing that any neighbours whose property is within 20 metres of the site of such application, and as a consequence, the Scottish Government considers the existing provisions to be appropriate with no requirement to amend them at this time. We have also received a submission from the petitioner noting that many of the notification requirements mean that members of the public must be proactive, for example, by checking online planning portals for new applications being submitted. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Mr. Torrens.
Considering it's a new petition, convener, I wonder if the committee would consider writing to the heads of Planning Scotland to seek a view on the action called in the petition, information on the number of applications being submitted for digital display boards, including what portion of applications are being granted or rejected. And I wonder if the committee could also write to Royal Tilton Planning Institute, Outsmart, a membership body for outdoor advertising industry, to seek their views on the action called in the petition.
Is there any other thoughts? Fine. I quite like them. not quite sure, but I've got a few in my constituency. They tended to replace roller ones where the picture changed, or ones with slats that used to turn, and now it's all modern tech. But I think, fine, we will keep the petition open, and we will seek to find out from the bodies concerned their views of these digital display boards, because of course it's perfectly possible they are somewhere that is much more intrusive and potentially of consequence to people locally. That brings us, I think, to the final petition we're considering this morning, which is to provide funding to have a CAMHS worker, Children and Adult Health Mental Services, worker and a nurse based within Scottish high schools. This has been lodged by Kirsty Solomon on behalf of Stand With Kyle Now. The petition calls, obviously enough, on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide funding to enable a CAMHS worker and a school nurse to be placed within our secondary schools. This is because the petitioner believes that access to a CAMHS worker and nurse would allow children who are struggling with their mental health to be identified early and to have any referrals completed correctly and efficiently. The SPICE briefing notes that school counselling services are available in all local authorities for children aged 10 and over. The delivery varies across local authorities, with some providing authority-wide services rather than allocating practitioners to particular schools or areas. In a 2023 report by the Children and Young People's Commissioner, further barriers were identified to accessing school counselling services, and the report recommended that all local authorities should have clear waiting time targets and that compliance with those targets should be part of the Scottish Government's evaluation of the services. The Scottish Government's response to the petition highlights that all primary and secondary schools in Scotland are able to access support of school nurse services. The school nurse role has changed over time and does now include a focus on emotional health and well-being. School nurses can support the mental health of children and make referrals to CAMHS where appropriate. So it's a new petition. Do colleagues have any suggestions for action as to who we might contact if we wish to keep this petition open and seek further information? Mr. Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if the committee would consider writing to the Scottish Government to ask how it evaluates the provision of counselling in secondary schools, ask how CAMHS referrals are monitored in secondary schools to ensure that they've been completely, correctly and effectively, and to highlight the Children of the Young People's Commissioner Scotland 2003 report on counselling in schools and ask what consideration is given to recommendations, particularly the recommendations about establishing clear waiting time targets.
That's fine. I think I would also maybe just like to add to that, seeking a little bit further information on the assertion that all primary and secondary schools in Scotland can access school nurse services, by perhaps just trying to quantify what the level of that resource actually is across Scotland, and to what extent it is being accessed, which I think would be useful to have some understanding of as well. Are colleagues content with the suggestions that have been made?
Yes.
We are, thank you very much. And that therefore concludes the public part of our meeting this morning, and we'll meet again on the second last day of this parliamentary session, Wednesday the 26th of June. And we now move into private session.